Welcome to Shelf Help, a channel dedicated to talking into the void about whatever book I happen to be reading. I'm your host, the reader. The following review will contain spoilers. This story takes place in a fictional version of the Asian Pacific. I am an American mutt, born and raised in the southern United States. The majority of my known heritage is Irish and Scottish. The closest connection I have to the Asian Pacific is that my childhood best friend is Taiwanese. I hereby apologize for all the names I'm about to mangle. The story begins at the end of a war. Tomoto has fallen. After taking over Sanbu, Dala and Shang, and by extension, Jiansong, in search for metal and in the practice of shade pacting, Tomoto finds itself the occupied instead of the occupier. It is time to negotiate peace between the nations. The people of Tomoto are metal pactors. They can extend their soul into anything metal and control it. So their cars don't need fuel or engines, their guns never jam, the bullets never miss, and their swords never lose their edge. They see themselves as the height of civilization, but despite their ability to pact with metal, they have very little of it. So they spread civilization while gathering up much-needed resources. For a while they were on top, but empires never last. Sanbu and Shang both practice shade pacting. It is the practice of sharing a bit of one's soul with a single non-human animal. They can then be summoned like a Pokemon. It is a partnership, and the terms are set by the animal. We see two examples of this, both through the character of Lee. Her first attempt at shade pacting is with a rooster who tells Lee he wants to bathe in the blood of his enemies between the cold and unfeeling moon, which is the most on-brand thing for a rooster to say. She's not feeling it, and the pact fails. Her second attempt is with a dog, who instead asks for love, because dogs are awesome. But in Tomoto's worldview, all animals have a soul equal to that of humans. They don't have pets, they have friends that happen to be animals. They also don't eat meat of any kind, so they view shade pacting as nothing more than slavery. And when they take over Sanbu and Shang, they outlaw the practice of shade pacting and the consumption of meat. So yeah, they're an entire country of literal militant vegans. But no one nation in this story is right or wrong. Sanbu and Shang, as a whole, do not treat their shades as slaves. But even Tala admits she could force her shade to bend to her will if she chose to. So it's not a surprise that while reading this, I often found myself humming a verse from Pocahontas. You think the only people who are people are the people who look and think like you. But if you walk the footsteps of a stranger, you'll learn things you never knew, you never knew. The story follows four characters in two pairs that eventually intersect. Tala is the first character we meet. A lifelong soldier, she takes her job seriously, and she's really good at it. She has taken on a last assignment at the end of the war. Take Iron Prince Jimuro home and see him become the Steel Lord. Jimuro is one of those characters that I'm just waiting for the anvil of reality to fall from its ever-fraying thread and land on his head. He manages to be both sheltered and worldly. He has a lot of schooling, but not a lot of contact with normal people. Despite being held captive by Sanbu for years, he knows nothing of their culture and shows no curiosity. Shade pacting is written off whole cloth as slavery, but forcing people to mine metal against their will is perfectly fine. He is quick to call the Sanbu Resistance monsters, claiming they started the war despite it being Tomoto that invaded. But when his people are actively slaughtering the Shang and Sanbu soldiers occupying Tomoto, they're patriots defending their home against invaders. Jimuro and Tala are a study in contrast. For Tala, it was a violent rending that stole her innocence before she even reached puberty and forced her to do some terrible things. For Jimuro, it forced him to the throne decades ahead of time to negotiate for the future of his people. He's not ready, and he knows it. Tala can't stop fighting because it's been her whole life. Sholan is the 28th princess of Shang, a bookworm and a police officer. Her life is a fairy tale, kind of literally. She sees herself as the rightful heir to the throne of Shang, and she will take that place and bypass all her siblings thanks to her close reading of her favorite fictional detective. And it's not that she isn't smart. She does outsmart her siblings. But her mindset that she is the inconquerable hero of her own story gets her into trouble. Li Yanji is a thief from the streets of Jiangsun. She has lived by her wits since her mother died when she was a child. Jiangsun has been under the boot of Shang for generations, with a brief reprieve under the boot of Tomoto, which was a distinction without a difference. When Xiaolin finds her, she is about to be executed. Xiaolin and Li's story very much parallels Tala and Shimuru's. One is poor, and the other is royalty, and their countries are at odds. But unlike Tala and Shimuru, whose relationship is contentious and moves towards understanding, Li and Xiaolan start with passion and move towards reality. Love isn't easy after all, and that's without the cultural or familial baggage to consider. So often, relationships in books is hate transitioning into love, which is both unrealistic and unhealthy. But for Xiaolan and Li, it's lust at first sight. They aren't pawing at each other from page one, but they never stop to consider how hard it would be for a princess to marry a thief, until it smacks them in the face. It's not just the cultural barrier. Xiaolan expects, like everything else, love to be like a storybook. The dashing rogue can be tamed by the princess's love, and everything will just work out. But Li has spent a lifetime being betrayed by her various partners. She's waiting for the other shoe to drop, and when it does, she wants to be sure it doesn't land on her. Now, I suspect, based largely on the foods I had to look up, as a side note, this book made me really hungry, that each of these countries is based on real-world counterpart. I am not a history buff of the Asian Pacific, so there very well may be historical events being paralleled here. But Tomoda strikes me as very American. It is a rich nation using its great military power to export its ideas on smaller, weaker nations, while also taking the resources it lacks to make itself even more powerful. Shimura was held for years by Sanbu, had daily contact with the leader of the resistance. But when we first meet him, he's still looking down his nose at Tala. Tala, who lost her entire family at 10 years old while eating dinner to a bomb his family dropped in retribution for a resistance attack they had no part in. He is constantly asserting his superiority. He is civilized, she is a barbarian. He is a vegan who respects the rights of all animals. She keeps a shade and slaughters animals for food. His people, his culture, his ideas are all better, and she is simply too backwater to appreciate all his people have given her from the goodness of their hearts. Jimuro, even towards the very end of the story, is convinced of Tomoto's inherent superiority. And maybe, in part, he's trying to justify what his family did. He was sheltered from the war, first by his family, and then as a rebel hostage. He never walked among either his people or the people of the nations they took over, very much like most Americans are insulated from the actions of the wars we start. Political fantasy is hard. It tends to depend very heavily on nuance. Not only do characters need individual motives, each needs cultural and personal pressures. It's especially hard not to make one character or country the good guy and the other the bad guy. All characters have to be very complex for this to work. And boy, does this story work. I'm also going to commend this book on its inclusiveness. Several of the main and side characters are members of the GRSM community, and every instance is treated as a non-event. Inclusivity isn't just about having a gay character and putting them on a pedestal. It's about treating people as normal, because it is normal. I'm going to put this on my top shelf. It's excellent political fantasy. The characters and cultures are distinct. So often political fantasy focus on the war, and not the aftermath. And while wars may be messy, the cleanup can be a lot messier. Thank you for your time. I know everyone's mileage will vary, so feel free to leave your thoughts.